going to come through. Slight delay. We're seeing which way they're going to go
taking
with
their
it.
Time.
They are. There's a lot of discussions going on this one. They've let the plot completely run down. It will be a ban, and it will be on Ziggs in that mid lane.
So Aatrox is another consideration against Freddy. We've seen Kayle banned out against Jezzers multiple times. If Kayle is available, SK Gaming will pick it up. Kayle is also a champion that the Super Hot Crew have run in the past. So we need to see which team is going to pull the trigger and get rid of that one first.
Well, it's all Twisted Fate. Slipped through the cracks earlier than Alliance managed to first pick. We'll see whether Selfie can manage to get his hands on that one. Of course, Yasuo was definitely the champion he's done well on. That's been removed. There is the Aatrox ban. I wonder if Superhawker just looked at Alliance earlier and thought, you know what, those bans are all right.
I don't see why not. Force Freddy into something a little different. See if he wants to play as Renekton. He's now defeated in the Summer Split. 4-1 is his record. He can pull out something like Irelia, which he's done in the past. But I think Kayle, Kassadin, Lee Sin are probably preferences. And if Super Hot Crew don't ban Kayle on this next round, they may be wanting to pick up either Kayle or Kassadin on this first rotation of picks and bans. And, I mean, look at the discussion. Selfie's really having a lot to say here, so you have to think it's going to be a mid lane champion.
Well, remember Mimer had Kayle in London and went huge on his team. 13 kills in that game for him, picking up triple kills left and right. See, the discussion clearly is being well thought out. It's Orianna. Jez has played that one against Alliance early on. That leaves a couple of things open. Jax, Renekton, Kayle all out there at the moment. As you mentioned, the LeBlanc. There's the Evelynn. That leaves Kayle open alongside Jax. Will they first pick it?
So if they do go for the likes of Jax or Kayle, and Sven Skaren locks in the likes of Lee Sin, which is what we can realistically expect, I don't think that's too bad for the Super Hot Crew, because Impala has run Jarvan in the fourth in the past. You can say whether you like or dislike the pick, he's done okay with it and he's picked up wins with it. It is definitely something that is in his repertoire of jungle champions. And considering that the priorities are off the table, we've also been hearing a lot of whispers and mumbles about the likes of Nocturne or Vi in the past.
Ooh,
so those are options as well.
Didn't even think of the Kassadin slipping through the cracks. And that has been first picked. It does mean that Kayle's going to go across to SK Gaming, it seems, for Jezzers. As Lowell as Sven Skaren getting his hands on Lee Sin. Couple of strong champions getting through into this game.
Oh, late game is already a decisive factor here for these mid lanes. And Jezzers and Selfie have actually both played games of Kassadin in the past. They've both played games of Kayle in the past. The question is, what is Impaler run in the jungle? Elise, Evelynn, Lee are off the table, so he has to go to next tier. Skarner's up and open as well. And another champion that we've been hearing whispers of, teams have been playing it in scrims. Whether or not we're going to see it in the LCS remains to be seen. It is available, and we just need to see what Super Hawker are going to prioritize.
Ironically, it was Jezzers that had the Kassadin against Super Hawker last time these teams met in London. Of course, Selfie that time ran Nocturne, this time around Morgana getting through. Will Kasing be picking that one up? And more importantly, will it be a Lucian for Mr. Ralas alongside him, or the Kog'Maw?
Well, the Nami is still available as well for Kasing, and his Nami bubbles and tidal waves were just phenomenal every time we've seen them. Going to opt to go for that Morgana this time around, and we're going to see another Kog'Maw today. So with Lucian available, Caitlyn available, trending away, at least today, in Europe in Super Week, and again, just more late game scaling. If Kog'Maw, Kassadin get more built up and more scary, it's a worrying combo that could be put together.
We see Zyra, Ashe, that's what I'm wondering.
Getting excited.
I am. Look, there's Zyra, there's Ashe. Look, Ashe is locked in.
Come on, lock it in. Now, dare I say it, it's the Cloud9 bottom lane.
No, because it was Korea before Cloud9.
Touche, but they popularized it in the West, and in terms of the LCS teams, I would definitely say Cloud9 were the most successful Western League team with the Ashe-Zyra combination, and again, late game scaling. The utility and the kiting power that Ashe will offer you will be very good at also potentially locking down Kassadin. You're going to have a stun, you're going to have a root, you're going to have knockups. So if Selfie doesn't pick the perfect time to engage, he's going to be in trouble.
Waiting to see what Super Hot Crew lock in here. I'll find the top lane.
Jarvan's such a good idea. Because
makes sense. It's a top laner we went Kayle, for as well.
Kayle's got no escape. Zyra's got no escape. Ashe's got no escape. This is a Jarvan pick that can lock in multiple members of SK Gaming. And if you combine that with some of the AoE or the damage that Kassadin could put down, and potentially this Ryzen, whoever the top player is going to be, I actually think that's a pretty good combination. The one thing that Super Hot Crew have done once again, like they did yesterday, it's a late game team comp. They fell behind against Alliance and they ended up losing the game. They can't afford to do the same thing because of how much control SK has. If somebody gets caught out, Intervention's going to save them. So Super Hot Crew have to pick the perfect time to engage to get through that and get through Zyra and get through Ashe Stun and get through Lee Sin disengage. So a lot of intelligent plays have to come down from the Super Hot Crew.
Yeah, hell of a lot of appeal for SK Gaming. Freddy lost his 100% win rate on Renekton earlier on. Let's see if he's going to go for something different. Aatrox, of course, was banned away. And as he mentioned, I die a lot on that champion. So I don't think SK are too worried about that one. One, is he going to play in the top lane? Holy moly. That's not what I wanted to see.
Okay,
it's now, a Yorick top
now,
lane.
Now, I actually like this pick in terms of SK's composition. Because when you get Yorick to use his Omen of Death onto either Kayle or Ashe in the late game, in the mid to late game, when they have items, when they can destroy people, Jezzer can come back to life and keep smacking people in the head with this potential Hurricane build. Ashe, if she gets, you know, Phantom Dancer or Static Shift plus Infinity Edge, can start getting a lot of damage down with those auto attacks, and it does give you that extra lease on life. Is it exciting to watch? Maybe later. In the laning phase, he's definitely going to be looking to bully Mimer around, get those ghouls out, get the sustain down, and make Mimer's life very difficult on that rise.
So we'll see how this one works out, ladies and gentlemen. Could be an exciting matchup, that's for sure. A lot of damage on both of those teams. We'll see how it develops as the match goes on. And now, of course, that you've seen the lineups, which duo lane landed the stronger champions? Tweet hashtag SuperHotCrewWin, SHC win, or SK win. For SK Gaming, of course, to at LOL Esports, and we'll check your votes in the game. Of course, it's a Zyra Ashe combo versus a Kog'Maw Morgana combo for the Super Hot Crew.
They fill very different roles. The AD carries. In that, Kog'Maw is just pure upfront damage. He wants to be sitting in place and just become an artillery machine, destroying whoever is in front of him. Ashe, on the other hand, is a lot more about kite and fight, a lot more about getting those frost shots down, those volleys, moving around the battle. But when you've got a Cassian that jumps in your face and a Ryze that theoretically runs you down, and a Jarvan that locks you in, it gets much more difficult. So a lot of pressure on Candy to be in the right place at the right time.
Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Game three of the day. It is the halfway point of Super Week. And the Super Hot Crew start out as the blue side with that Cassian in the mid lane. Up against SK Gaming, who themselves have the super-powered Kayle.
And Super Hot Crew have got two teleports. So Selfie and Mimer looking to have those globals. It is 4.10, so just reminder, plus 40 seconds on cooldown if you do throw to towers, which just means it's a little more punishing if you get bullied out of lane early on. And no looks of lane swaps yet from either of these teams. I think the Ashe Zyra, the return to Ashe Zyra, and the fact that Super Hot Crew is such a late game team comp could actually work for Candy Panda. It'll be quite difficult for Super Hot Crew to punish them unless they commit all of the teleports. And if they commit all the teleports and it doesn't work, they're going to be very far behind.
Well, Ashe is absolutely a champion. The Candy Panda has a lot of games on his belt, of course. He's been around in the game since Season 1, back in game.d, alongside N-Rated back then.
Back in the...
Was it N-Rated?
I think so.
It wasn't N-Rated. It was...
Oh, I'd be lying to you. But the Ashe mid days, I mean, that's how long Candy Pan has been playing.
Was he Nif? It was with Nif.
Advantage to Kasing as he puts down the Tormented Soil. Get some gold back. Bit of a dance off as Mr. Rawls is having some fun. And we are going to have head-to-head matchups. So I expect a somewhat similar, you know, levels 1 through 4, where Kog'Maw may have a slightly difficult time against Ashe and Zyra. But then once Mr. Rawls gets some of that Biocane Barrage leveled up in his W, he can then start poking down from range and trying to force Candy Panda and rate it backwards.
Kasing starting out, getting his gold early on, getting the Tormented Soil down at level 1, which gives him that gold advantage. Mr. Rawls has taken some early poke out there. Can he return that damage on towards N-Rated? Rated clearly coming out on top in that exchange.
Yeah, definitely. And it is something that Kog'Maw is going to have a slightly difficult time with until he can outrange his opponents. Tabs did in the previous game, or game one of the day. Fell behind fairly early, but then made up for it later. I want to see if Mr. Rolls gets more involved. Against the Lions yesterday, he was very passive, and it was somewhat uncharacteristic.
We'll see, of course. Candy Panda faced a Kog'Maw for tabs in the first game of the day. That didn't go too well for him. He knows exactly how these exchanges will work out. Question is, can he counter it? The junglers, we haven't seen too much of them. You can see they've both gone and got their first buffs. Double buff being picked up shortly, and both actually down in the lower half of the jungle.
Yeah, a big CS difference already building in this mid lane for Jezzers. 12-6, and he's obviously going to outrange Selfie whenever he puts that Righteous Fury down. So we have to keep an eye on that. How negatively affected is Selfie? In addition, how negatively affected is Mimer? Because they've both got difficult lane matchups. Sven is sniffing around bottom, but I think this is an optimistic gank. The only way I can see it working is if they tower dive and a grasping root lands. But Mr. Ross has got flash, has got heal, and obviously if Enrator's taking that poke, that's not really going to give them the confidence to go under the tower.
Well, they're going to make their way up towards the top. Svenskeren will find Impaler. Impaler don't think wants to fight this one. Svenskeren instead will use his smite and steal away the big raid.
So again, small advantage, and just, you know, it's the little things that count. Selfie's still only 6 CS down, so one minion wave behind. And that's really the story I want to keep tabs on, because I think if Super Hawk Crew can put themselves in a position where Ryze and Kassadin are on equal footing to, you know, Yorick and Kayle, it comes down to decision-making and team fights, because SK have got so many save my life buttons. You know, Omen of Death, Intervention, Dragon's Rage Kick, Stranglethorns. Like, SK have got such a good reactive team comp. And they'll be looking and waiting for Super Hawk Crew to engage, which is what Super Hawk Crew will be doing as the game progresses.
Freddy reading the situation there, realized that Mimer being aggressive, and Impaler is stood on top of a ward. So he knows he's still there. And this time, though, he's going to get caught with the Rune Prison, not going to get knocked up in the air by the Flag and Drag, and will get away safe. So Selfie actually backed away, used the teleport to go back to lane. Got himself a Doran's Ring on top of that flask. Double Doran's Ring picked up by Jezzers. He's just been back. We also saw Mr. Rallis go back early on, having to get himself that longsword because he'd taken a lot of punishment in the bottom lane.
Yeah, really, really under
and
pressure.
And Ken has taken more punishment.
Yeah, non-stop. Every time Candy Panda or Enrator get in range, they're really making Mr. Rallis' life very difficult. And I actually expected Tabs to have been punished a little more in game one of the day. And it just feels like Candy Panda and Enrator maybe a little more comfortable on this pairing than they were earlier, you know? So, decent start, double the CS of his opposite number, and as far as the Twitter question is concerned, you've got a clear winner in the first 5 minutes.
Yeah, 39 CS to 20. Mr. Ral is well behind on this one, Kasing even stealing away some of his CS there. So, Jezzers trying to put some damage onto Selfie. Selfie turned that back around with a bit of a force pulse and a null sphere in the face. Of course, he's going to fall behind in CS. You'd expect that against the KO. KO's just a lean, mean tower-pushing machine when he gets going. And even this early on against a fairly passive Kassadin, he will put some pressure down.
Can I have a momentary cool story, bro, moment? For the All-Star Game analyst desk, when I had to introduce Crepo every morning, he said to me, Trevor, you pronounce my name wrong every time. So here's the trick. For anyone that wants to know how to pronounce his
surname, Force Pulse.
Just say Force Pulse. Say it like you would say Kassadin with a bit of a lisp. With his so it's Mitch Crepo Force Pulse.
Force Pulse.
And they said, that's how you say my name. So cool story, bro, moment over. We're back in game, and SK with a small lead.
That's lovely. Thanks for that. I'm sure Mitch would be delighted to hear your story.
I'm certain people on Twitter will be asking if this is a true story or not. And I sincerely hope you do, because he will confirm it.
He'll confirm it. Freddy going aggressive on mine. We haven't had a great deal of view of this matchup, but we don't expect it to be too overly aggressive. Mimer, of course, with that tier, is going to build up towards the Catalyst, needs to get himself farmed up. Freddy may be looking to be a bit more aggressive on him, but as it stands, with Svenskeren waiting in the wings, we'll see whether he goes for it.
Yeah, and Sven stood right on top of a ward. So much like Impaler's attempted gank earlier, the vision gives information to his opponent's top lane, and Mimer does have flash, does have that movement speed from his Desperate Power ultimate, so going to be able to back away. Falling a little behind in CS, and something you do need to remember is every time Mimer kills one of those ghouls, it will be increasing his CS count, but it's not giving you the full value of gold. I think those ghouls only give about 5 gold per kill, so Mimer, we need to keep an eye on how his gold level builds up. They've caught Candy.
There we go, Mr. Ral is going aggressive this time. Candy Banner in trouble, Ignite going down. Kasing going to continue chasing, flashes away from this one and will survive. Very low hit points there from Candy Panda once again.
Notice as soon as Cogmore manages to get some levels, the difficulty seems to be levels 1 through 4. We'll get to that in a second as it looks like Impaler, can he land the flag and drag?
Impaler is going to come sliding through Cataclysm on towards Freddy. He's trapped in there with Mimer, but he will go down. That first blood, Freddy's ultimate. Can he get on towards Mimer? No, he's just going to have to finish off some CS.
And that is the risk of running the Yorick. You get locked into the Cataclysm. There was no flash available. He ends up giving up first blood. Because of the fact that jungler was top lane, it does mean that SK Gaming will be able to grab themselves a dragon. And Tabs is a bit of fun.
Tabs hoping that this does not return to be a thing, but SK, they're trying it out there. Of course, Wicked, a lot of players got some strong views on these champions.
Well, definitely having some fun. Feeling confident after their win earlier today, that's for sure. And Superhot Crew lose the dragon, but they gain first blood. It also goes to Mimer, so that's very important to note. Ryze is the one that got that last hit, so he can, in theory, begin to accelerate. I want to go back to the Cogmore discussion, because Cogmore was bullied by Caitlyn until level 4, level 5, and as soon as Mr. Ryze hit level 5, you can notice Candy Pan has fallen behind in CS, even though he's got a BF sword. Mr. Ryze and Kasing landed the Dark Binding, and they punished Candy and Enrated. Candy Panda also ate about 1 million bubbles, and he needs to make sure he's dodging those skill shots, because on Caitlyn he couldn't do it earlier. With the 90 caliber net, he doesn't have that luxury on Ashe.
And remember, he's going to be going for all that Infinity Edge, so he's going to be a little bit slow to get going. As you mentioned, he's got nothing to escape, nor is Mr. Ryze, to be fair. But as you mentioned, if Kasing can catch him, he is in all sorts of trouble. Right now, no flash, no heal available for him, so he's in danger mode. Mimer going full on aggression straight in towards Freddy's face there. They've only just returned back to lane, got himself built up, and that was a big win for Mimer in that exchange.
Yeah, gonna at least come out ahead in CS. And of course, now that Mimer's got his ultimate and the Catalyst, the Protector, his sustain is arguably even better than Freddy's. So this is going to become a battle of just attrition and farming. Who can deny their opponent's CS, and who's gonna get the assistance of their team's jungler. Notice that Freddy is really committing to this extended late game, or maybe even extended laning phase, because he's picked up a Chalice of Harmony. He really wants to spam, he really wants to farm. And I'm very interested to see what his next item is going to be.
Well, flash available, Selfie looking to try and come up there, trying to go aggressive. Pink Ward actually been put down by, I think it's either Mimer or Impaler, not sure which
Mimer.
One.
Yeah.
Put it down there. We'll clear out that vision. Of course, that was the problem early on. Impaler getting himself the red buff. We do see Svenskeren making a move towards the bottom half.
Second time we're seeing Sven try to make a move towards the bottom half. But again, his timing is when the minion wave is collapsing on the tower. So either Sven is not reading the situation correctly, or Candy Pan and Rated are pushing too hard, because he simply hasn't been able to make a gank happen. And I would dare say the only real gank attempts this game have been from Impaler. The first time forcing the flash on Freddy, and the second time securing first blood. So props to the Jarvan, doing some pretty good work. And there again, Mimer probably coming up fairly even in the grand scheme of things in that trade.
A lot of damage going down, but as you mentioned, fairly even, clears out the wave. That pushes back on towards them, Freddy. Ironically, you know, it was Mimer that pulled out the Yorick originally back. Well, I say originally, obviously, a number of people have, but back in the regional Gamescom for Ninjas in Pyjamas. Kind of caught us off guard, and
it
was less than impressive.
Didn't work very well at the time. It's one of those champions where you've got like a hyper carry. If you've got a champion that can bring back to life with high damage per second, it can work. And, you know, an auto-attack-centric Kayle or an auto-attack-centric Ashe in the late game, I can actually see it working. But again, you need to get those champions to that late game. Anyways, Cataclysm is available. Slam dunk option there for Impaler. He wants to try and impale Freddy. But unfortunately, Tao's going to go down.
Well, forces him to get away from that one. Flash burn out there. Now they're going to put pressure on. But meanwhile, this is all happening. Selfie is having some serious issues in that mid lane. You can see he's trying to keep Jezzer at bay. But Jezzer's already taken down that mid turret, just hammering away towards it. Svenskeren coming around the bottom lane. He can go towards Kasing. Kasing already low on health. Will he catch? No! Dark Binding. That's going to slow things down. Quick going to go on towards him. They're actually split all over the place here. Svenskeren's in trouble. Kasing's actually soloing him down. The minions are on him. The range minions. Can Kasing chase coming around the side there? He does have the support of Jezzer, but Svenskeren losing out in a straight up fight to a support.
Yeah, wasn't able to get in range. It was such a good Dark Binding from Kasing to prevent Svenskeren scared making anything happen. So the teleport from Selfie ends up saving a further dive or the tower. And because of the presence in the bottom lane, it meant there was nobody to help Freddy out in the top lane. So Superhot Crew invest a lot, They save their teammates, and they secure their first tower of the game to bring the gold within 1,000.
So, bottom lane, Candy Panther and Unrated, they took some damage back in that fight, that exchange, but of course, Kasing did burn everything. Oh, that's a good dart binding, and it is going to find out. Mr. Rales does get vision of Unrated with that ultimate. They're going to keep on pressing here, and they're going to force Candy Panther and Unrated back.
Note just all of the vision wards that have been picked up by Mimer, Impaler, and Selfie. They've got red trinkets themselves, and they've picked up a bunch of wards to put down. Considering there's double teleports and just how mobile Jarvan and Kassadin are, if they get good vision down, you can have very good setups. And you know, if you think back to the Challenger Series finals from London, just how good Jarvan plays can be if you can sneak around your opponent's ward placements.
Well, look at this bottom lane. Candy Panther has got Flash. Impaler's looking to come down here. You can see Mr. Rales. He wanted to clear out those minions very quickly to put pressure on, try and get it on towards the tower. But Candy Panther stuck around, and he is going to get rewarded with those minions.
Yeah, and for Super Hot Crew, the mid to late game tower dive prospects are very low. Oh, they're going to go on Jezzy.
A lot of damage on them. Quickly getting out of range of the tower as well. Intervention has burnt out. Impaler with the ignite running down. Taken low, they have to back out. That's a good 2v1 for Jessus.
Yeah, not too bad. Intervention, Flash, and Ignite was burned. So if you compare resources committed, Super Hot Crew come out ahead. Unfortunately, they pick a fight and lose it before Dragon spawns. So this means that Super Hot Crew are gonna have positioning as well as grouping, as well as the opportunity to pull Freddy down. Mimer's actually just got his teleport available, so a contest could happen, and Impaler's gonna be late to this fight.
Kasing simply going to have to throw down his
tormented soil.
I don't think they're going to clear this one. Oh, here comes Mimer. He's going to go straight in towards the team. They're going to lock on towards him. Does not manage to catch it. Candy Panda throw the arrow out and completely missed. It went too early. But Freddy gets the kill on Mimer nevertheless, and then they just go straight back into the dragon.
Yeah, Super Hot Crew needed to collapse around Mimer at a faster pace, and it couldn't happen. Impaler's thinking about this. Ooh. He's gone in, doesn't get it.
No, and that's going to be the death of him as well. He's not going to get out. Good grasping route there from Enrated, and that will be the kill. Selfie's not going to be able to take this turret down. The Super Hot Crew are slowly slipping away from this game.
Both of those kills land in Freddy's back pocket, so his slightly odd build is going to come to fruition somewhat quicker. And what I like about SK's team composition is just every time Super Hot Crew want to make a play, you've seen how powerful Intervention was. In 1v2, Jezzus saved his life. Super Hot Crew teleport into a team fight. Enrated just put Stranglethorns down. No one else can commit and get involved or get in range. So SK will always, in my opinion, have the advantage when they've been jumped on, as long as they are grouped, because they're going to have all of these spells and abilities to positively react to Super Hot Crew's aggressive plays.
Well, Candy Panther's got his Infinity Edge completed before Mr. Rales' Blade of the Rune King. That's a problem.
Yeah, 20 CS advantage, 2 assists. To be fair, Candy Panther got a strong early lead, a very strong early lead. You know, he was 20, 30 CS up for most of the game and has continued to keep that advantage going. So, well played to Candy. Blade of the Rune King just completed by Mr. Rales, so small momentary advantage. But it's going to come down to whether or not Candy Panda gets caught. If Candy Panda can kite Mr. Rales with Frost Shot and with volleys, he should be able to, you know, put more damage down. But if he does get caught, Blade of the Rune King plus percentage on Mr. Rales is very high.
Boots of Swiftness booked up by Jezzers. We haven't seen that one for some time. Of course, that's going to help out with his E. Candy Panda trying to sneak around the side, Kasing not letting him. And at the moment, it is a small stall as the lane phase closes out. And of course, Super Hot Crew, they could do with it going a little bit longer here. They've only just turned those Rod of Ages in from Catalyst, so they're going to take a while to stack out here. You can see this mid lane, SK Gaming, they're focusing once again. And all four members
arrow
moving in. The arrow is going to catch on towards Selfie. Will they follow through in it? No, they're going to focus on Impaler instead. They kick him in. He has to flash away. Svenskeren now locks up. He's got no one to safeguard to. He goes down.
Yeah, Svenskeren goes way too deep. Doesn't have the support of the rest of his team. And he goes up. That's a good flash from Candy Panda this time around.
Soul Shackles from Kasing. Will back away. Taking very, very low. Mr. Rales can't really chase on towards this one, and Selfie hasn't really got the manager to go engage.
No teleports from either of the top laners, so this battle is going to continue chasing out. If Kasing or Enrated land the crowd control, that could be the go signal. Impaler's looking for the flag and drag, and Super Hot Crew, they're not dead yet.
Oh, wow. Jezzus just blows up where he stands. Didn't get a chance to use intervention there. Now Candy Panda's in trouble. He's going to get caught out. Flag and drag, it's a double kill picked up for Mr. Rales. They can close on towards N-Rated. Will they dive? It seems they won't. But nevertheless, it could be the tower for Super Hot Crew.
And just like that, the damage from Cogmore is really going to skyrocket. The two kills and potentially the tower is such a good turnaround. Super Hot Crew fell 5,000 gold behind Alliance, would win a key team fight, bring the gold within touching distance. Then Alliance yesterday would pull ahead of Super Hot Crew. Let's see if Super Hot Crew have learned from yesterday's defeat and avoid falling further behind now.
Well, Mimer's keeping this top tower alive. He's barely been touched by Freddy the whole time he's been away. Meanwhile, Freddy, of course, he's got no backup, but he's still feeling very confident in this top lane despite Super Hot Crew clearing out that mid. So, second turret of the game for Super Hot Crew. Genske, of course, taking their own. And this is going to open things up. The bottom laners starting to get their power spikes on. You just saw Mr. Rales when they have two explosive kills. More importantly for Selfie, Cassidy starting to get rolling. And we still know, despite the changes, how strong a Cassidy can be.
Yeah, I want to see what he builds, because we've seen full tank Cassidy's going, you know, Frozen Fist into Iceborne Gauntlet into Frozen Hearts and similar builds. And I'm also interested to see a Brutalizer picked up for Mr. Rales. He really wants to get a mid-game spike. If he's going for a Ghost Blade, it's slightly different to what we're used to seeing, because Blade of the Rune King into Trinity Force into Eye Edge is something that's, you know, dare I say, standard on Cogmores, but we don't see them frequently enough to even use that term that abrasively or that strongly. So I want to see how he itemizes and also how effective it is. You know, throws down that Biochem Barrage, throws down Ghost Blade, gets the range, gets the attack speed.
Make sure, of course, Kenny Panda, who played Cogmore the other week, got caught out a few times. This time around, he's going to be looking to catch out the Cogmore with that arrow from Ash that can throw out there. Continuing defense, Mimer in that top lane. He's getting fed CS, honestly. He's constantly being pushed up against him by Freddy. Has fell behind a little bit in farm. Trinity Force now completed by Freddy in that top lane, so he's looking to go full-on melee damage more than anything in their faces.
Yeah, hasn't gone tanky yet, so maybe looking to be a split pusher and try to duel somebody that gets in his face. You know, I don't really know, outside of team fights, bringing Kale or Ash back to life, what Freddy's objective will be, but he's got sustain, he's got slow, so he can maintain presence in a lane. And SK have always been able to force objectives through pressuring other lanes.
You've got to assume it would be the Kale if he goes down, because that Righteous Fury is so strong in teamfight.
It's one or the other. You've also got to remember, once Ash gets to like three or four items, that's also a terrifying champion because of the utility that she brings and the slows. Anyways, Dragon's up in 20 seconds. Super Hot Crew are positioning correctly to defend this one. Mimer's got teleport available. And it looks like we may see another fight. Keep in mind, SK won the previous team fight because Mimer teleported into the middle of SK Gaming and just got quite literally deleted.
Well, this could be the third dragon of the game for SK. They've taken the last two, of course. It does mean an Impaler. He tried to get in and steal it with a smite last time around. He's waiting, not going to get in there again. Another easy take for SK.
Super Hot Crew way too late to respond. With the Trinity Force Yorick, the Lee Sin damage, Kale damage, I mean, it just went through way too quickly. So Freddy responds by defending the top inner turret. No teleport blown from Mimer, and Super Hot Crew will pick up a tower. So tower for dragon still keeps them about 3,000 gold behind, so, you know, probably fair trade.
Fair trade keeps him pretty close overall. Candy Panda, I'm interested to see how he builds this one out. You may have seen North American LCS the other week, and of course hearing Kobe get a little overly excited about a potential Static Shift second item build. He was definitely focused on that one. Phantom Dancer was picked up, though. Let's see what Candy Panda does at the moment. He's still sitting on that Zeal, so I'll see whether he decides to build into anything else at the moment. Not going to go for it because he's still farming out the gold.
Yeah, I'm going to start recalling in a moment or two. Hurricane been picked up by Jezzes. So, sort of core items on this auto-attack-focused Kale have been secured. And he's going to have the opportunity to go towards a death cap. So the questions for how Selfie's going to build Kassadin have been answered as well. Zhonya's Hourglass is most definitely the second item. Also, keep in mind, Selfie has not even picked up boots yet. Still sitting on that flask, still sitting on wards, and just relying on the mobility of Riftwalk to keep him relevant. And Candy Panda did go for the Phantom Dancer. So, you know, already starting to build up a lot of damage. Once he gets some armor penetration in there, that's going to be a scary Ash already.
Ooh, hello, Mimer. Freddy in trouble here. He's got three members coming around him. He's got Flash available. I don't think he's going to be used because he knows he's already going down here. The question is, can SK gain something from it? Freddy tries to get away. Not going to happen.
No, there's nothing you can do. 3v1, and there was no way to get away. Unfortunately, no mobility. So an easy kill for Super Hot Crew. But look how long the Ghost lasts. That's a very good reminder at how long a Yorick Ghost lasts. Ultimate Ghost, rather. For if or when he can actually give that to Jezzes or Candy Panda. But we need to see him actually grouping and not being shut down. That CS advantage he built up has been quashed by some repeated ganks from Impaler and now attention from Selfie. But it hasn't really accrued or built up to map presence yet.
Yeah, and despite SK's early lead, Super Hot Crew clearly pulling themselves back into this one. Mima playing a dangerous game with three members of SK just off at the side there. That's actually going to get drawn in towards them, so they will take down that. Interested by the Runen's Hurricane. Jezz is going for that as his second item. We've saw a number of different builds for Kale, mainly going for the heavy AP over the last few days.
Yeah, it's actually been a lot of the other teams that have been running AP, but Jezz is still sticking to the auto attack focus. Everyone else going for burst. And I do just want to highlight in Rated, he's got an early Haunting Guise, so going to get towards that Liandry's. And he's going to be another fight. You see, Super Hot Crew are scared to commit because in a 5v5, Ash Arrow was actually thrown out there by Candy Panda. They have to get through that, Stranglethorns, etc. And the reason I highlight the Liandry's is with the changes to Mikhail's Crucible, this is the reason we're seeing Zyra's support coming back into it, Nami growing more. Because you don't just have that guaranteed, this is what I build on every support first item. And it's nice to see even more damage from SK Gaming's side as well.
Selfie's going back down towards that bottom lane, got himself the Zhonya's almost completed. This farm should finish that off for him. He only needs the 500 guild gold for that last item. That middle inner turret, very close to going down. SK can just take that one out next push they make on it. They could have actually committed for it there, but they didn't want to risk it. There was no reason to. Mima saves the top turret once again. Every time Freddy goes up there, Mima quickly reacts and clears out the wave.
I actually have no idea who will win late game because I like both teams in the late game. And I really think it comes down to... I actually think it comes down to how effective SK Gaming are at buying time. If SK don't buy enough time with Intervention and all of their CC that I've highlighted a million plus times, I think Super Hot Crew can run them down. But if SK can, you know, delay and stall their opponents effectively, I think they should have the advantage in the team fights just because of how much more CC they have available to them, in theory.
Well, we saw Jezzes, of course, not able to use the intervention last time. He got caught out too quick. That's a big difference.
Yeah.
If he gets explode quickly, which Mr. Rala, Selfie, Mima combined, there's a hell of a lot of damage there, a lot of bursts coming out from them. Same with SK Gaming. So it's really a case of who focuses who catches somebody out first, and who gets caught out, maybe even without Ash Arrow. Dragon back up in over 1 minute. And this time, Super Hot Crew may actually, for once, have themselves positional advantage.
Yeah, so to summarize the last 25 minutes of gameplay, SK take a dragon, kill someone from Super Hot Crew, Super Hot Crew gank Freddy. That's happened 3 times. And that's basically the story of the game. Twice resulted in a kill, and if you look at all of the builds, Selfie's not even picked up boots. You know, Freddy, he went for a Chalice of Harmony. Everybody seems quite content to continue scaling and continue working towards this late game. Selfie manages to even sneak away that blue buff.
Yeah.
Very, very sneaky indeed. A little bit of a misplay, considering Spence Garen actually had Smite, but he lost vision of the buff, so... you don't have vision, you can't cast. Oh, that's a whiff!
The arrow whiffs out there, and Super Hot Crew taps on it. Candy Panda caught out! Intervention used very early on by Kasing there. Soul Shackles will lock up Candy Panda. He's going to go down. Now he's going to be Jezzes trying to run away from this one, but Super Hot Crew forced them away. It was a support for an AD carry. Super Hot Crew clearly in the advantage.
Such a difficult situation for Candy Panda. He got locked down by so many abilities. The Flash Binding caught him out. Then the Soul Shackles from Kasing, that locked him down as well. Super Hot Crew have opted to focus down the tower because they can get the tower and peel back for the dragon, and they're not done yet. They're trying to force SK away.
They've got to get this inner turret. Selfie may have gone a little too deep on this one. They're going to collapse around him, but Senskaren's now caught out. He's got to try and safeguard away.
The Cataclysm!
On towards him. Freddy comes back around. He's got a lot of damage. And Impaler may well go down from this one. Selfie trying to work away. Mr. Rala's in the background. He's going to take down Enraged. Comes back around. Locks back on towards Freddy. So Enskaren gets exploded as well. And it's a triple kill for Mr. Rala.
Triple kill secured. It's 4 members of SK down in response for losing 2. They also got themselves an inner turret in the process. 5 kills locked down for Mr. Riles. The Ghostblade and the Blade of the Rune King did a whole lot of damage. They are low on HP, but there's no one from SK around to even contest this dragon, so this should get them a lot closer to even gold. And SK were unable to prevent Super Haku running him down. Their key abilities were used defensively and reactively, as we predicted. Ash Arrow didn't hit. Stranglethorns wasn't enough. And Super Hot Crew just did everything right.
And the ghost signal for Super Hot Crew was the moment that Ash Arrow missed.
Yep.
In his Candy Pie, they fired it off. Kasing, you've got to give him credit, landed that dart binding,
got off the
straight onto Candy Panda and the Soul Shackles proc on him as well.
So very, very well played. And, you know, it's just, it's the risk that SK have taken in this situation. Yes, you can use Ash Arrow aggressively, but with the rest of the team composition, they are focused around a reactive playstyle. And unfortunately for SK, that particular situation just goes wrong. So that gold lead that they've built up has been evened out, and Super Haku continue their patient sort of farm style of play, and they're doing very, very well this game. Also, Selfie still hasn't bought boots. 28 minutes in, Void Staff is his next item. You know what? He doesn't need shoes if you float, I guess.
Well, one thing you've got to give SK credit for, they can hold games out if they don't surrender, and Super Hot Crew have also...
It's the truth.
Super Hot Crew have, in the past, many times made bad decisions.
Many times. You know, they've literally given up the leads that they have accrued by overcommitting to team fights. And the man that you're looking at has been guilty of making those decisions. His Yasuo initiation on Darien...
God, yes.
It literally cost him that game. He jumped in, only caught one person, and it is a problem. Now, I do feel like Super Hot Crew are more in control this game. If you look at how they've moved around the map, if you look at their decisive plays, even though Mimer engaged at a bad time in Dragon, it still felt like it was a team call. It still felt like the whole team was moving forward. So for Super Hot Crew, as long as they continue up this coordinated and patient play, I think they're in a good position.
Super Hot Crew are making moves towards this bottom turret. Impaler almost caught out, does back away. 5 members though, Super Hot Crew going to push on towards this one. Dart Binding goes through, doesn't land a target. Of course, Candy Panda now with that Banshee as well, making sure he doesn't get caught out a second time. Super Hot Crew, they've got a bit of tower pressure here. They can keep on poking, especially if Mr. Riles can land them ultimates.
Yeah, very quickly notice that Candy Panda grabbed that Banshee's Veil. He needs that to be popped. The thing is, against a Kog'Maw, it's actually very easy to pop that Banshee's Veil. Just spam those living artilleries, and then you can let the Dark Binding go in. On the same token, Mr. Riles picked up the Fura upgrade boots, so as long as he's auto-attacking with range, with his Bio-Arcane Barrage, he can then continue kiting. Sven is caught, but I don't expect Super Haku to tower dive. It is a scary prospect to go underneath the tower against this team comp from SK. They're just using their range very effectively.
Yeah, of course, Mr. Riles, he's going to get them free shots on towards it. Just hits that W, the range, and just pokes straight on towards it. Meanwhile, SK do have great wave clear. Jez is with that Hurricane. Candy Panda, of course, volley shotting non-stop. Enrated also, laying down those plants. Now that he's got that Leandre's completed, he's starting to do some damage. And actually, if he catches someone out, he can put a lot of damage down on them.
Yeah, he really can. And if you look at Mimer, who's stacking up HP, as well as Selfie building up HP, you know, even Impaler, he's got a decent amount. That Leandre's will do a fair amount of work. So SK have held off this bottom lane siege for a while. And it just looks like Super Hot Crew are happy to steal away the rest of the objectives. Clear the jungle camp out, steal the blue buff away. I mean, Selfie took the last blue buff as well from a very well-timed Null Sphere. Look at the damage on Freddy. That's 2 or 3 auto attacks and, you know, 1 or 2 overloads from Mimer, and they drop a bunch of his HP down.
There's plants coming down. You saw Selfie's like, nope. And look how much damage actually on Selfie there. That was only Enrated.
Well, Enrated's got a lot of damage. He's another mage. He's not built like a support. Yeah, he steals some gold, or he accrues some gold from that Frost Queen, but he's just built full mage. So this is the problem that Super Hot Crew have now. They stacked up in the bottom lane. They tried to force their hand against SK, and they obviously didn't tower dive. I don't think they really want to, especially not when they're on this even footing. What I'd like to see Super Hot Crew do more of is push multiple lanes. Ryze can wave clear pretty well. Selfie can, Kasten rather, can wave clear pretty well. And because they both got teleports, hell, play the map. You've got the summoner spells, you've got the tools. They just need to make use of it. Selfie, 32 minutes, still doesn't need boots.
Yeah, he steamed across, stole away the red buff, goes back to Pi. Doesn't get boots, doesn't need them. Zhonya Zaugas completed, void stamp and Rod of Ages, which he's had a long time ago. Deathcap is the next focus for him. Candy Panda didn't get his red buff, that was stolen by Selfie. And Rated's going to join alongside him. The AD carries, Mr. Rala's Infinity Edge is the next focus for him.
Yeah, we'll have to ask the guys over at the LCS preview show to do some digging. Wonder what the longest game is somebody hasn't bought boots, gotten away with it. I imagine you could just start with Kassadin games, because his mobility is obviously incredibly useful in that regard.
We would say Janna games as well, but we haven't seen Janna in that long.
In a long time.
It would be a long way back.
It definitely would be. And unfortunately, SK's initiations in the past haven't always gone well. Candy Panda's, you know, yeah, he caught Selfie earlier in the mid lane with an arrow. Didn't really result in a whole lot. Whiffed the previous Dragon fight, but with Dragon up in 30 seconds, we'll have to see if that's the next time, next port of call, next objective to battle over.
Split pushing. Candy Panda, I think, is looking to line up a ulti on Selfie here. I think that's what he was looking towards.
But
arrow,
Selfie can just Riftwalk it. If, as long as Selfie is paying attention, he should be able to Riftwalk it.
Panda's purposely trying to stay.
Oh,
he could just duck his hourglass here. That's the other option, of course. He was trying to stay out of range there. Saw him the moment he ripwalked in on towards him. Candy Panda jumps in there. Enred Paler trying to take some damage, but that's going to be a lot of damage on the backside. This is what we talked about. The turnaround from SK Gaming catching on towards him because he's taken low. Freddy going to get dropped down. Not quite enough. Mr. Rallis having that ultimate running towards him. He's trying to turn it back on towards Candy Panda. Selfie goes back in on this one. Mima tries to explode him. He's got a lot of damage resistance with that Banshee's Veil. Selfie comes in, gets himself a double. Can he make it the triple? Gets knocked off the side. Instead, it's a double. Mr. Rallis, he gets on towards him, and the super hot crew react nicely to the actions of SK Gaming.
1-3, the counter engage is where super hot crew make it work. SK, they manage to fend off Impaler, who goes under the tower, gives up his life. Unfortunately for SK, they then made a super hot crew mistake, and they themselves overcommitted. Chased super hot crew down, and if it wasn't for Selfie running out of mana, that could have been even more.
That could have been a penta for him.
It really could have, yeah. But he did burn through his mana pool. And this is the threat of the tower dive. Even though the Ash Arrow had not been, or you know, had been wasted, SK Gaming are so split up. You know, you've got the ghost of Freddy moving down, the rest of the team's backing away, and Super Haku just re-engaged. That Void Ooze slow, plus the damage, and another great binding from Kasing. Pay very careful attention to Selfie's mana pool. Just completely burns through it so incredibly quickly. Ends up getting two, ends up being three for the team.
Probably Svenskeren still had his ulti kick available to actually knock him away. If he'd have been not knocked and stunned on towards that tower, it could have been bigger. But nevertheless, Selfie 317 on a Kassadin. How many times have we said, you cannot let Kassadin through the pick and ban phase? Normally, it's not, but this time around, SK clearly were trying to bait this one out. They got it themselves against Super Crew in London. Now they're against it. Jez has went big on it, Selfie is going bigger.
It's one of those things where it makes you think maybe SK had thought Super Crew were going Kale. Maybe Selfie wasn't, you know.
Well, Mima went you huge make on the London, as I mentioned earlier on.
Exactly, and it's one of those things where it's like, maybe they're going to go the other route. You know, it's 50-50. If they go one, we get the other. Hey, we've both got an OP.
Yeah.
But Super Crew, I don't even think it's the Kassadin that's, you know, so game-changing. I really just think it's the team decision-making. I've never once felt like Mr. Rolls has been at threat of dying.
Yeah.
Not once has SK Gaming even been in Mr. Rolls' face in team fights. Mr. Rolls struggled in the laning phase up until level 6 because Candy Panda and Enrage did a good job of shutting him down. But that has not meant anything because in every team fight, Mr. Rolls just sits in the back line, spams all that spit that he can, and he manages to go 6-0-4.
I don't think Candy Panda's going to be firing the arrow itself.
I don't know why he fired it the first time.
Position. Well, they were in the right mind. He did fall. He just walked in, so there was a potential. If they got him, they could have turned the game around and done very well. But as it stands, backfired horribly. Looking at Candy Panda. He's not with the team right now. He's down in that bottom lane, and Impaler is moving in on this one. He's got the Flag and Dragon Cataclysm, everything available to him. They're trying to create a situation and catch SK on the back foot, but it's not happening. They're not falling for it.
For the record, Candy Panda has also been sitting on just the Infinity Edge Phantom Dancer Banshee's Veil for a very long time. Mr. Riles has got his completed Infinity Edge plus Ghostplay plus Blade of the Ring King, so he's got a lot more offensive power in his kit. And because he's not under threat from SK Gaming, he may even opt to go for another offensive item Is his next point. Alternatively, if he picks up a Quicksilver Sash, the one hard engage from Candy Panda in the Ash Arrow can just be instantly negated. So Mr. Oz has got a lot of options in front of him. And still no boots for self.
Looking at the teams, they've not got a great deal to deal with Mimer in the late game. Obviously, he's going to be building up tank. He's got his Frozen Heart.
It's going to be...
Panda's going to have to work on him. And as you mentioned, N-rated, it's going to be the one that's maybe going to have to become that second mage to put the damage.
I feel like it's all going to be on N-rated making sure he gets a good Grasping Roots onto Mimer and Impaler when they jump in. Because they do have very telegraphed attacks.
No pressure, buddy.
And the problem for SK is... They have to wait for Super Arc Root to engage. Yes, Asher can work, but you've seen how easy it is to dodge. And it just hasn't worked out in favor of Candy Panda for the first 40 minutes of the game. Quite similarly to when Wulai played it. You know, it just was a fairly lackluster pick.
Well, at least Tabs would be happy.
I'm sure he would.
He does it on the Ash Siren to come back. It worked out fantastic in lane. Let's not discredit that because they were doing very well in the lane phase. And if they can transcend that into a late game, it's a problem. Super hot crew getting some poke on towards Freddy here, finding out the plants, clearing those out. They do see that pink wall there, so they might want to try and get in and sweep that one out. Let's see if Super Hot Crew don't fall for Millennium's mistakes, as once they get the lead, start that Baron dance. There's a big wave in the bottom lane. Double teleports, remember, for Super Hot Crew if they need it, so they can keep this split push going for a very long time.
Yeah, and I really think they should. They've got all of the tools to move around, to lock people down. Thanks to the power of the Black Shield from Morgana, if anyone from SK does actually dive onto Super Hot Crew, the reactionary support play with the Soul Shackles is very powerful. And we've seen how quickly Mr. Rolls can melt through targets. So anyways, Minion Wave is on the bottom lane inhibitor turret. Super Hot Crew are continuing to play the Baron bait. If anyone from SK goes to deal with it, you've got Selfie pushing the top lane. Blue team turret has been destroyed. I didn't see where that one went down. Was it mid lane?
It is, yes.
Yes, there we go. So mid lane inner turret has been dropped. And it looks like minions for Super Hot Crew are taking bottom lane. There's more action with our minions than with our champions.
Yes, they are just staring at each other. Super Hot Crew starting out the Baron here. It's been taken pretty low already. SK Gaming coming in. The peel on Freddy is the one that's caught out, but he is a full tank now on Yorick. And the Super Hot Crew back away.
Yeah, Super Hot Crew are so terrified of the Ash Engage. Part of the reason they haven't overly committed to...
They're going to go. They've just seen Selfie in the top lane. SK immediately react to this one, rushing down the mid lane. Teleport is available if he needs to get back there quick.
Super Crew
so
split. Keep
pushing.
This is cost Super Crew games in the past by being split up and making bad decisions when under pressure. Now Selfie's going to get this top inner turret, and he may need to teleport to the middle to defend this one.
Well, they're going to try and defend it out, but the Kale on towards it. The Ash Arrow goes across, but it only catches on Mimer and Kasing. Teleport coming in there. N-rated taken incredibly low already. You can see Mimer belted in towards him. N-rated caught out the side. First current goes down. N-rated taken low. Selfie quickly caught out there. That's going to be another kill. It's Kale doing the damage from Jezzers. Now Mimer's peeling off the side. Where are they going to follow on towards it? Candy Panda locks down Mr. Rallis. He explodes. And currently it's a pretty close matchup. Jezzers is going to have Selfie just off of the side there. Selfie can turn back on towards Candy Panda any second now. And Jezzers knows about this one. He can try and put the damage back on towards him. Quickly flashes away from it. Selfie looking to riffwalk on towards Candy Panda. Where's he going to go? Good volley on towards him. Selfie has still not got the boots on towards him, so he can't chase back in there. That's going to be the teleport. Freddy joining back in the fight. SK peel off. Mimer peels off. And they all disengage. It's a 2-for-2 fight.
2-for-2, but Super Hot Crew got the top inner turret. Part of the reason that ended up working so well for the SK Gaming is exactly what we talked about with the Yorick ultimate being thrown down onto Candy Panda. He got a lot of additional auto attacks on by being alive and having his ghost there. And because Super Hot Crew were very split up during the course of the fight, it allowed SK to focus the right target at the right time. And this is the mistakes that Super Hot Crew have made so many times that they've made even against SK Gaming all the way back in week one of the split. Super Hot Crew just under pressure, not making the most decisive, most impressive late game calls.
Say what you want about Selfie's build. He's got a hell of a lot of damage, but if you can't get close enough because you don't have boots, you can't use it. That DFG didn't even get fired off in that fight. Zonya's Hourglass did, but as was proven, he couldn't chase down Candy Panda, kited for days.
Yeah, Mikhail's Crucible has actually been finished off by Freddy from that chalice. So he's opted to go for a little bit of a support item, and there's actually one picked up for N-rated as well. So they really want to make sure that they can, heal people up, get them out of the dark binding. And when you consider that the Darkbinding and the Rune Prison are the only real hard CC outside of Cataclysm that can hold SK down, that's very, very smart itemization.
Well, double teleport both being used for Super Hulk crew. Freddy's was used. Looking across the builds, of course, Mr. Alice died for the first time in that engagement. I wonder if he's going to go through a Mercurial Scimitar here.
I would think so.
Got the buildings of it. He could, of course, switch across. Maybe go for a Banshee's Veil. Jez has got him Banshee's Veil completed as well. Selfie down the bottom lane. As I mentioned, no teleport available. No boots on him either. SK Gaming, they have the position start Baron, but it's a dangerous play if they go for it, and they're choosing to just simply move back and defend.
Yeah, really waiting for more of those summoner spells to become available. And, you know, we've got this sort of standoff with two teams that have very, very good power. I think the last team fight for SK is definitely going to be a confidence boost for them because they haven't actually won a team fight in probably 20 plus minutes. You know, all the previous Dragon engages and bottom lane pushes have gone the way of Super Hot Crew. And that was the first time that SK actually used their positioning and used their crowd control effective enough to control Super Hot Crew. And for the Super Hot Crew, I think they have failed at split pushing. With a double teleport team, I do not feel they have put enough effort or emphasis in pushing the side lanes. You can argue that it is because of the engage power of the Ash Arrow that makes it easier to get shut down, of course, but I do feel they haven't done it well enough. And I think with two teleports, if you're not playing the map, you've purposefully put yourself behind in terms of combat summoners.
Well, Selfie has proven he's absolutely no intention of buying boots whatsoever. So, going to play the whole game without them. Maybe he is setting records now. 44 minutes gone, no boots. No boots going to be showing in this entire game. So, who needs them? Magic penetration. It's for wussies.
Fair point. Mobility's for wussies, apparently.
Apparently so.
But you know what? We can't really criticize him. He's 318, so
no,
he has been doing a very good job. Majority of the teamfight Selfie's jumped into, they have been well thought out, and he has gone in from the right angle. So, you know, all props to him.
He's split pushing across. He's going for the inhibitor turret. SK Gaming are not reacting to this one. Super Hot Crew, they could push on this one. They have to push their mid lane. He's already put the minion wave on towards it. You can see Jez's is going to react. He's backing away.
Yeah, SK Gaming don't really feel confident enough.
Oh.
They're split up. This is the split decision making that can cost games. Selfie has opted to stick around. He should be able to get away before Jezzes can get in range. And even if Jezzes does, obviously Riftwalk can just get him over the wall. Look at the blue pings onto Baron. Supercrew are trying to find ways to force SK's hand. And then once they force their hand, they can react. Teleport is available for Selfie, will be for Mima in a moment or two.
Yeah, shows himself and gets caught in between SK Gaming's
front line.
Oh, this
could be a fight.
There. Could try and poke
wow.
it towards it. A little bit of burst on Freddy. Strips 1,000 hit points off him.
That's not bad damage, but it's even better sustain from Freddy, who just heals himself right back up. Doing such a good job with the Spur Visage and, of course, that Omen of Famine that is going to give him all of that HP back. But I do think it's quite impressive. If Selfie gets onto one of the squishier targets with all of the AP that he's got and maybe the DFG, that can be a very scary scenario.
Selfie's going to move across. He fancies this one. Is he going to go up against Jezzes? Jezzes will wipe that wave out. Mimer's going to join him. I think he's just going to counter it. He is actually going to try and fight him. And immediately, Jezzes backs away from that one. Freddy shows himself in the top lane. Mimer tries to sneak up on there. And they want to try and 2v1. Jezzes down this time around. Mimer trying to sneakily make his way through.
That movement speed for Jezzes is massive. He's currently got 430 ability power, and his Divine Blessing gives him 60% movement speed bonus for 3 seconds. So it becomes, I would dare say, even impossible for Kassadin to chase him, especially Kassadin with no boots, when he throws that down. So for Selfie, he really wants to burst Jezzes out instantly. And I think for the first time we're seeing Super Haku try a split push. You know, Selfie was pushing bottom lane. Mimer appears to be chilling for the time being, making some s'mores.
He's been stood around for a long time down there. I don't know what he's doing.
He's just checking out the view. Waiting for Summoner's Rift 2.0, looking like one day I'll be able to look over the edge of this side of the map. Still there. I mean, there you go.
he's not even like...
You know what it is?
Subtle.
He's miming a fight.
Oh.
Oh.
I see what you did there.
Yeah, that was
next level stuff, that one.
That was pretty bad. Neither team's committed enough to make any play. And they're both...
Can we say Rocket Millennium?
No, I don't think it's that bad because there's a little more commitment to moves. But the reason we're not seeing it in this matchup is SK's team is reactive and scary when they get forced into fights. Super Hot Crew are not confident at forcing team fights unless they know key ultimates are down. if they know the intervention is not available, if they know Stranglethorns is not available, I think they'd be willing to commit.
They're going for it. Baron, Peel going in towards it. Impaler takes a peek, steps out. SK Gaming haven't peeled. That inhibitor turret's being forced on. We're going to see the teleports. They've got nowhere close by to teleport into. Mime Impaler going to get caught out. They can get the jungler down. It would be a good start for them, but they can't get it. They have to go back on towards the Baron. The Baron back on 11,000 hit points. That inhibitor turret's going down slowly but surely. That will drop. It's going to be a Baron for an inhibitor turret. The inhibitor wing will go down as well, but it will be the Baron. Teleport way too late. Enrated all over the back there. He's going to get taken low. Can the Super Hot Crew clean up here? That's the question. They are going to dive in towards it. Enrated actually gains hit points because he gets caught out. Selfie having to hit that Zhonya's. He's only going to focus on the support. Now he realizes he's got to force, try and get away from this one, but SK Gaming are collapsing up towards him. They're suddenly grouped up. Candy Panda gets himself one kill on towards Selfie, but there is a big minion wave in their base that they have to go back and deal with. That inhibitor did not go down though, and SK
Mima's
can push.
The inhib. So they're going to be end up trading for a Baron for an inhibitor. Mima should be able to secure that one. SK Gaming have decided to keep pushing on. They've got a few minions left to play with. In terms of the team fight, Super Hot Crew got completely controlled. They couldn't get the kill onto Candy Panda, and a last second summoner heal plus divine blessing from Jezzers kept him alive. If this inhibitor falls, SK are going to be much further ahead thanks to the Baron buff, and they're going to get out cleanly. Impaler's thinking about going in, decides against it.
Didn't have Cataclysm available or Flash, so would have been a dangerous play. Freddy defends out. Nexus turrets are safe, but it's an inhibitor for both teams going down. But the Baron buff for SK, we'll see what they do with it over the next 4 minutes.
Yeah, I feel like Super Hot Crew were forced to make a decision, and the fact that they had not made a play or pushed the map for a prolonged period of time may have forced their hand in going for that inhibitor push. They end up getting the inhibitor, so you know that's fantastic because you've got super minions, but now they have to deal with super minions of their own, and they have to deal with their opponents at Baron buff. But that's two team fights back to back that SK Gaming have won. So confidence is definitely, and momentum is definitely swinging in their favor.
So, Super Hot Crew though, get themselves the Dragon, which keeps them in the gold lead now. It's gonna be very tight, nevertheless. We're talking close to 80,000 for both these teams. And as you can see, both these teams fully laden right now. Mid laners, complete items. AD carries, complete, almost items. Mr. Rallis hasn't quite finished off Banshee's Veil, which he seems he's heading towards now. It was a Bloodthirster, by the way, that he went towards.
And that more lifesteal. And considering how many auto attacks Mr. Rawls is planning on getting down with his Eye Edge, with his Blade, it kind of makes sense to just get even more sustain because he may be able to lifesteal through whatever damage is being put down on him, especially if he finds himself, you know, in a duel with Ashe, for example, who has not as much lifesteal, obviously, with just the Blade of the Rune King. But if you compare Candy Panda, 20 minutes ago, thanks to the farm, thanks to the objective, thanks to the Baron, he's now equal damage, dare I say, with Mr. Rawls, arguably more armor penetration. And SK Gaming are just going to sneak a tower. This is what I was hoping to see from the Millennium Rocket game earlier. Moving around the map, catching your opponents unawares, and literally face tanking a turret because you got there first, you had better positioning, and you had enough itemization to get safely through. So a very smart play from SK.
Well, Selfie's pushing that top wave still, keeping the super minions at bay, and SK Gaming could take full advantage. This inhibitor turret will not take very long to take down, but look at that. Mr. Rall is putting the burst stack on to Freddy, but look at the heal that comes out of Jezzers. Puts him straight back up there. Mikhail's also used out from him, and quickly he regains all that hit points. The Baron buff still on him, and Selfie is back.
There is another Mikhail's available for Enrated, so if somebody gets caught again, Enrated can save them. Nevertheless, the important thing to note is Selfie's bought quite a lot of time. By shoving out those super minions in the top lane, it's going to allow Super Hot Crew to continually defend this bottom lane. But look at that heal on Freddy. Jezzers has got so much ability power, and he's even got a lot of movement speed. He's gone for the Alacrity upgrade on top of his Boots of Swiftness. So he's going to be running around and literally running circles around his opponents. Look for the super minions in the top lane. When they get to base, I think that's SK's signal to look for another fight.
Selfie's back to wave, cleared that middle wave again. Candy Panda looking to maybe try and sneak around the side of him. Don't really fancy a one-on-one head up. The rest of his team will track through. That's a successful defense from the Super Hot Crew working out well, and Selfie's going to get the blue buff in the process.
Yeah, Selfie's got so much damage, and you know he does have the ability to burst somebody down. SK in terms of the Baron buff, it has actually worn off as well.
910 ability power on Selfie.
Oh, that's what you get when you don't have boots. I mean, he's also triple potted up, double potted up rather. So, gonna have all that bonus AP. And I think the key for Selfie is to get on the right target. He has to give, kill Candy Pan or kill Jezzes early on. And if he doesn't do that, the damage that's coming out from them is just very, very high. I would probably say Jezzes is more of a target than Candy Panda because of the threat of intervention. So if you can get him down, ideally, during the knock-up time of an Impaler Flag and Drag, that's a perfect scenario. Inhibitors respawn, and we're just going to keep going back to this. Whoever's out of position first, game.
Who can get the next Baron? Spawning in just under 2 minutes. Waves actually being pushed out quite heavily by Super Hot Crew. We'll see whether they do manage to drive this one out. And Candy Panda's positioning was brought into question over the last few games. Was caught out of position. And it's going to be vital in this next engagement. If Selfie or Mimer, Mr. Rollins, anyone can get on towards him, take him down quick, it will be a serious problem. Because if you think of the last big exchange that did happen, the two that were left standing was Jezzes and Candy Panda.
Yeah, and it's just smart play and positioning from SK. Super Hot Crew in that mid lane fight a few minutes ago were surrounded. And if you traditionally go back to 50-minute games of SK and 50-minute games of Super Hot Crew, Super Hot Crew make a mistake that costs them the game, and SK Gaming don't make a mistake and punish their opponents for making one. It happened in week one. The clip that we ran over an hour ago at the beginning of this matchup, we showed how Jezzes and SK forced Super Hot Crew back from their own base. SK lost both Nexus turrets and then pushed Super Hot Crew to their own base and then ended up winning the game. We're quite realistically in store for another super dramatic ending. And it's going to boil down to whoever pulls the trigger in the wrong direction first.
One thing I would possibly maybe level at SK is with a 72-second cooldown on that arrow, why are they not firing it more often?
Oh, Candy's missed so many times.
That's true.
So
I mean, maybe just said, screw that, they're firing it more.
The thing as well, right, not only is it, yeah, 1 minute sounds like a small period of time, but when you've got two opponents with teleport and the very quick engage Subaru can put down, the only reason Subaru went into that Baron fight earlier is because they knew the Ash Arrow was down. They knew one of those very important tools was unavailable. So, face check from Impaler. He's caught out.
Oh, there is the arrow. It doesn't really do the job, though, because he'd already slid away.
And the Black Shield was up as well.
He's very low on hit points coming into this fight, though. There's the Scrying Orb. They have full vision. They know that the Baron is being started out. Freddy's actually getting focused on him. Not too sure exactly why. He's the big full tank. Impaler goes deep on this one. Cataclysm going in. Selfie follows through there. There's the burst damage they were talking about. Impaler gets dropped down. He can see Kasing trying to glock on towards him. Soul Shackle's being used, but he's just going to get focused on Jezzes with a quick swipe of his blade, does the damage. Candy Panda locks on towards him, but look at this. Selfie tries to sneak back around the side. Now he's taken low. Mr. Rollins gets Candy Panda down, and the rest of SK are actually backing away. Mr. Rollins, untouched around the side, can continue chasing. Selfie hasn't got the movement speed to collapse on towards him, and it's a 1-for-1 AD carry for jungler.
So at the end of the day, Mr. Rollins being left untouched yet again is the determining factor for the Super Hot Crew. He was sitting on the back line, spamming out all of the damage all day long. I really like the way SK Gaming handled that fight. They dealt with the engage, they re-engaged, but for the second time, I think, this game, SK just simply chased too far, and they just put themselves in damage's way. So Candy Panda gives himself another death, and Mr. Rawls is going to secure this dragon uncontested. SK are moving towards Baron, but I don't know if they're brave enough to start this one off. This could go very wrong. There is a ward in the pit there from the Super Hot Crew.
Yeah, they could try and rush it, but again, you can see two teleports are up for Super Hot Crew, so they have to deny the vision. They can't start that one off. But of course, well, we're going to see Impaler back up. Candy Panda will be back up in a moment. Nobody gained anything.
I really like how that fight played out, because it wasn't a matter of mistakes from either team. Both teams played the team fights very well, and it was just like a counterplay. Impaler went in. He was confident the Black Shield was going to come down. He was confident in his flag and drag, and he did get out. But unfortunately for Super Hot Crew, they couldn't get more because of the fact that they couldn't get through all of the abilities. Now, they're the ones rushing down Baron. There's all of the abilities available for SK Gaming. Ash Arrow is up. Stranglethorns is up. Candy Pan is holding on to their Enchanted Crystal Arrow. He figures Wraith Camps, hashtag worth it.
Well, you can see he wasn't with the team, but the arrow can, of course, traverse the entire map. if required. This time, though, SK, they've got positional advantage to push down the mid lane. They're going to go for it. You can see in the top lane, Selfie actually trying to push the minions in. Super Crew a little bit corralled out the way here. They could go for Baron, but they may lose the base if they do.
The last time this fight happened with Super Crew relying on Selfie joining late, the crew were out of position. Now, Super Crew do have a Lichbane Cassadin that should be able to melt through these towers, and the crew have got a better position on this objective. The question is, does Candy Panda fire the arrow? Tower's down.
Tower's gone already, straight away. Quick work there from Selfie, and great position from Super Crew. SK Gaming, this time with the undecisive pair, and they have to back away.
Now, this is the risk and probably the reason that you're seeing Alacrity upgrades. I mean, Candy Panda has gone Captain upgrade, actually, on his Ashe. So nearby approaching champions are going to get a movement speed increase. I'm not quite sure how much of a frontline champion you're planning to be, Candy Panda, but that is an interesting upgrade, in my opinion. And what ends up allowing Super Crew to get the tower is the fact that they can dash over those walls and move very, very effectively. So tower secured, but again, it's not real control. It's just another objective in this very long, very drawn out objective game.
Big wave in the bottom, Selfie clearing it out, and immediately SK moving towards the Baron. Scrying Orb being used by Mr. Rallis. He's going to give note on that one. There's nowhere to teleport. He's using the flak to get on towards. That means he's going to put him in amongst SK Gaming. Quick, it's a Lemon-rated. Just drop where he stands. Couldn't do a thing about that one. Freddy's taken very low as well. It's Candy Panda. They want to get on. Jess in trouble. He has to use the Zonya's Argus intervention on himself. He goes down. Selfie just motors on through the rest of the team. Candy Panda focuses on. He gets dropped down. It's a double picked up by Mr. Rallis, and Super Hot Crew are just plowing through SK Gaming. He's got nowhere to go. Freddy's going to go down. It's Super Hot Crew, surely, that can take the game. They're going to run for the base.
There is no doubt in my mind, and in dramatic fashion, the Super Hot Crew find SK Gaming, melt SK Gaming, and Super Hot Crew will force SK into a 0-2 day in the middle of Super Week here in Europe.
We should point out there's some maximum minions being taken down. 589 for Selfie, 552 for Jez. There's some records being made certainly in this game. It's an hour-long epic, and it's the Super Hot Crew that come out on top.